Welcome to Unwritten Stories of Significance. We got a show for you this evening. My guest is Simi Jayeoba. She's a young lady that I found on Instagram. She's not only an engineer, she's also writes poetry, and she has a fascinating story for you and to inspire young people to go after your dreams, believe in what you can do, and in the meantime, enjoy the journey. With no further ado, Simi Jayeoba. Welcome, Simi, to Unwritten Stories of Significance. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Joy, for that introduction and for having me on the show.
Oh, you are so welcome, beautiful lady. It is a pleasure. Now, I know that you've done an event with me, Woman to Woman, and it's a pleasure having you on Unwritten because not only your presence, but your story fascinated me through the pre-interview, but also your poetry. So I know about you, but our viewers don't. So if you can introduce yourself to our viewers and we'll take away from there.
Sure. So as you said, my name is Simi Jayeoba, and I graduated last year, just about over a year ago, from McMaster University, where I studied engineering physics. So I lived in Hamilton for some time, but originally I'm from Toronto. And when I was in high school, another interesting fact about me, I also started wrestling, and that was a very involved journey. And I continued on with that journey at McMaster, and I wasn't recruited there, but by the end of my time at McMaster, I'd been team MVP 3 times. I won the provincial championships twice and got a national bronze medal. And I also got to be a captain of the team and see the growth of the women's team specifically. So yeah, now I'm back in Toronto, starting my career in engineering and writing a lot of poetry and trying to share that in and around the city.
Wow. As I listened to your introductory there and through our pre-interview, but just listening to you right now, share it. This story is going to be great for young people. A lot of university students, even graduates, going in, choosing their career, believing in themselves, is going to be really evident right now. But just taking it back a little bit, did you always know or knew that you wanted to get into engineering? Was that something, okay, I'm going to go to school and I'm going to get into engineering and do my thing?
No, definitely not. I actually started in life science at McMaster. So I think as a kid, I gravitated to reading and writing, but I was also interested in biology. And I think also just coming from my background and also having the sort of personality that I did, I was very concerned about, you know, the path that school would lead me on, just in terms of like choosing something that was career-based. So I started in science, and then I wasn't sure what I was going to do with science, and I switched to engineering. But I think also part and parcel with that was hoping to be able to develop my skills to be able to help others in meaningful ways. So I used to watch a YouTube channel that talked a lot about kids with disabilities and saw some of the technology that they were using to increase their abilities. So I think that was part of what interested me, and I'm definitely still on a journey to find the ways that I want to use engineering to affect change into the world. But yeah, I'm very fresh for now.
Very fresh, but very successful at what you do. You celebrate each and every success as you go along the way, right? Was it hard to transition? Like, you're in school and obviously you say, okay, I'm not going to do this, I'm going to go into that. Was it hard?
I think the difficulty was making the decision. I was very nervous, and I thought that everything I did in first year or in making that choice was going to define a lot of my future. Mm-hmm. So I was very nervous, and ultimately I don't think it did. But yeah, the actual switch wasn't too difficult. I'm not sure that there are that many people switching into engineering, but My grades from first year science were good enough to allow me to do that. And I also had a teammate who is older than me on the wrestling team, who is very positive and encouraging about going into engineering.
Okay. And what is it that you do full-time right now?
I work at an engineering consulting company that designs buildings.
Okay. So you graduated last year, you said?
Yeah.
And now you're in a full-time position.
Yeah, that's correct.
So Simi, that rocks. Like, come on. Like, there's young people out there right now who are struggling to actually find a job. But what did you do? Can you share with our student listeners and up and coming? Did you do things on the side? Did you do internships? Like, did you do anything to empower that CV to be powerful for your interviews?
I think that I have a strong resume and CV, but I think ultimately the process of trying to land a job just presently can be very discouraging. And advice that I received was actually to try your best to not allow that to define you as you go through the process, because it simply can't. And I was advised that there have been people who really allow it to bring down their self-esteem. So that would be my first piece of advice, that it's not easy, but it's also not a reflection of you. And ultimately for me, the big element of success that I had came from failure. So finding my full-time position was a process of failing to get a co-op. So, and I think it all worked out very well in hindsight. I think I was going kind of 100 miles an hour and trying to find a co-op during the summer, but I wasn't able to. So I ended up coaching wrestling and working for a nonprofit wrestling organization that I was familiar with. And when I was offered a co-op position for the fall term, I was too busy to take it on, but I let them know when I was graduating, and that blossomed into a full-time position.
Wow. You got to give yourself a pat on the back, man. I'll do it for you. That is amazing. You're welcome, sweetheart. Failure. That's a big thing. And we're going to get into more of your story because you got some fascinating things to share with our viewers. But failure, it helped you. Can you define that for me? Because a lot of them, students, young people, look at that as, ugh. But now you're saying it helped you. How did it help you, Simi?
I think it helped me instrumentally, just with going for one specific thing and failing to get that thing, but it ultimately becoming something that was much better for me. I think broadly, the notion of failing in life, I don't know. I think this might be an indirect answer to the question, but I think that something that probably makes me uncomfortable, for example, I used to be more active on Instagram and I had a personal account, but I think that people are constantly having small failures, but you can still be moving in a certain direction. And so I think that the kind of engagement that we have with each other often highlights our best moments. And I think objectively, you can also have a lot of success and do a lot of things and have a good story to tell, which I think I do. But ultimately, there are parts of my life that people won't see. There are difficulties, there are hard days. And I think everybody fails all the time. So you need to learn how to give yourself flowers for what you do and keep with your intention, whatever that is.
I'll tell you right now, my love, that's very, very well said. Very well said. That came from a really, you're welcome. That came from a beautiful spot, a beautiful part of you. Wrestling. How did you get into wrestling? Like, it was high school, you said, right? Was it high school?
Yeah, it was high school. I think I was actually in eighth grade and I had gone to a school that was outside of my community. I wrote an entrance test for it for math and science. And mm-hmm. there was an orientation and I I think this is a real memory, but a girl got on stage and she talked about being a wrestler, and it was the first time I'd heard of that. And she was also in the fashion club. And I think growing up, I always liked to arm wrestle like my male classmates and stuff, but I wasn't very physically like literate, I guess. I didn't do a lot of sports growing up, but I just liked the concept of something that I had to throw my entire body into, quite literally. And yeah, and also seeing that a person can be a woman, can be beautiful, can be wrestling, that I just found that very exciting. But I started wrestling in grade 10 because it took a year to convince my mom.
Oh my gosh. It's like me. I got to share this real quick. It's like me when I tried to, I bought a motorcycle. Honest to God, Simi, I had to hide the baby in the laneway before I introduced it to them in the morning. So I know where you're coming from. It was not an easy conversation. So how was that? Introducing it to your mom, like, how did you sell her on the idea?
I think just persistence. Ultimately, just persistence. Every couple weeks or months, can I do this? Can I do this? Just persistence.
And you took it right through to post-secondary too, right?
Yeah, I did. I started in the first year, and I had a longer journey in undergrad, switching programs. And then also my final year, I won a big award. So that encouraged me to stay on full time as a student to finish the rest of my courses.
And how did you deal with that? Doing your wrestling, going for competition, going to competitions. How did you handle that with your studying, with engineering? Like, come on.
I think that one of the biggest differences that I had in my educational career was finding just one good friend. I think having one person who was going through the same coursework as me and, you know, was resilient the same way, and who could also just support me in understanding things I wanted to learn. If we had to stay up late, we had to stay up late. So I think in my first couple years at school ahead of the pandemic, that was a very big factor, and also in the first year of the pandemic. And then I think my last 2 years back in school, she was on co-op or just not around. So, but I think by that point, I was just very dedicated to what I wanted to do. So if it meant staying up late, I would do that. But that said, my last year after, you know, running at about 100, I think everyone, you know, runs out of gas a little bit. So I certainly had my moments that were more difficult, and it was hard to even sometimes get even things that seem simple done just for being so tired. But ultimately,
you did it.
I did it. Yeah.
That's it.
I did it well. So
awesome, honey.
But, yeah.
Awesome. On that note, we got to go to break. We'll be right back with Simi to share some amazing stuff on our next chapter. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Unwritten Stories of Significance with Simi Jayeoba. Simi, that was incredible. Oh my gosh, that was amazing, hon.
Thank you, Joy.
You are so welcome, man. You know, not only full of inspiration and your wrestling and your transition and your journey through school, you really, really tell a story very, very well. And our listeners, our viewers are going to just love it to pieces. But now let's get on to the next part, which I love so much. What got you into poetry?
I've always enjoyed reading and writing, but I think starting to really write poems more probably was in 2019. And actually, thinking back, I was definitely writing before that as well, but I think it became a tool and a vehicle to understand my own feelings. So a lot of my poems that I wrote in that time were just sort of meditations and reflections for me that I would tell myself. So the process at that point was very spontaneous. I would just write an entire poem and I would instantly memorize it. And now it's more a thing that I try to craft. Yeah.
Wow. So, okay, I'm going to ask a lot of questions on poetry because it blows my mind how somebody can write poetry and sometimes the endings don't rhyme. Like, you know, you'll say one line and then it has to rhyme with the next, but sometimes it doesn't. And when I heard yours, when you read them at the event, it just blew my mind. Like, how does it come to you? Like, you just lie on your bed and you just start writing, or you get up, you get an idea. Like, how does it really come to you? If you can just build a picture on that for us.
Yeah. So one of the first poems I remember writing, I was walking home while I was living in Hamilton, and I saw the Hamilton Mountain and also just the general area that I was in. And I recalled a lot of experiences that I'd had in that place, and sort of hearkening back to moments where I had strength. And I just wrote a poem while walking down the street, sort of thing. But yeah, in recent years, it's certainly slowed down, like the process is slowed down. So I will have an idea and then I'll think about it and then I'll write a line and sort of think about that. And then, you know, eventually sit down and write it all out. So it can vary the process. Yeah.
Yeah. How long does it take you to write one? Or does each and every
hard
one
to put
vary?
A number? Yeah, each one can be different. Yeah,
it can be all different. Wow. Now you come up with some unique titles. So in total, now before I forget, all these questions are rolling through in my head. How many have you written so far?
I haven't counted properly, but I would say maybe 30 or 40 poems, but I really haven't sat down and counted, and I'm not sure how many of them I would beat my chest to read, but I think they're all part of the process of creating. Yeah.
Exactly. What is your end game with your poetry writing? Do you want to put it into a book? Do you want to put it into something where audio that they can listen to you read? Like,
that's funny you should say that. I think in 2020, I thought a lot about recording myself reading my own poems. You found my poetry on Instagram, which I've slowed down on sharing it on Instagram, but I do have work up there. And presently, I go to a lot of poetry readings, and I would love to publish a book one day. But yeah, I think balancing different things. So I don't have a published date yet.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, my love. You read, I think it was two at the event, right? And throughout the interview, I just fell in love with both of them. And there was one that was called Severance. And the one that I would like you to read now is because I want to talk about it, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
And it touched a very, very good friend of mine. So with no further ado, Simi Jayeoba reading Boar.
Hey. This is called Boar. Sometimes I am broken by the thing that's already left me shattered. And before I can move, I can only look with waning interest at this bog at midnight, sky pitch dark. Not even blue-black to frame leafless trees or light the beauty even here. I am bored, not quite to the point of sinking, but there are holes in my woodwork I just can't fix. And grief is the air song, shrill and monotonous, gliding over and through the pits, pitch plebeian, and I am so bored. I am vintage, tattered, and distressed aches, damaged in the cast on, the phrase growing since 1990. Some plots you grow within, like skin. Some stories you tell again and again, folklore unchanging. Again, the hair has lost and is crying distraught, shattered and bored.
Wow. 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 Why the title bored?
I call it just bore. And bored. I think prior to that one, I had written